Wonderful to be here in the house of God this morning. Amen. 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 It's a privilege and honor to minister here where God has raised hundreds of great men and women of God. Amen. I've always enjoyed Pastor Terry's messages, and I enjoyed Pastor's worship also this morning. And it's a privilege to be part of IPA. We have long association with IPA, and while I was entering the church, I remember that Uncle Job Gnanaprakasam dedicated my sister, and Pastor David Prakasam was there for my wedding. He solemnized my wedding. He preached at my sister's wedding. So we have long association with the church and the family, and it's a privilege to be here this morning. Amen. Thank you for the privilege. Thank you for the opportunity to minister here in this church this morning. Amen. Are we ready to listen to the word of God?
Yes.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. So we live in a now generation, amen, where we want everything to be ready immediately. Yes, from instant coffee to instant rava idli, you know, from watching a video in few seconds. I don't think so. The generation now know what is buffering. Yes, 10 years back, we would wait for probably hours to watch one full video. But now, I don't think so. My kids know what is buffering. Yes, we live in an instant now generation. Yes, and what we need, if it's legitimate, it is good. But if it is not legitimate, if it's not what God desires in our life, it becomes dangerous. Yes, we have an example of that in Bible. Turn with me to Genesis chapter 25. We can see the story of Jacob and Esau, the twins born to Isaac. We see that Esau returns home after a tiring day at the open country. He's famished, he's hungry, he's tired. I think probably I understand that you know the context here, so I won't immediately jump into the story of these two brothers. Yes, so you know, Esau is a hunter, and he comes back home really tired, and we don't know if he really caught something, or he came empty-handed, or maybe a hair, wild hair, or something. But he returns home hungry to this aroma of his brother cooking lentil soup, you know, but his smart, shrewd brother is there cooking the, making lentil soup. And this brother, elder brother who returns home hungry, wants to, eat that soup, and the smart brother wants him to exchange it for his birthright. Now, if you know in the Hebrew context, birthright is actually, you know, it means one who gets major property and, you know, who gets to be the priest of the family and the head and the authority of the family. It is a treasured, possession. It is a treasured, precious possession. And here we see that Jacob wants his brother to give his birthright to him in exchange for that lentil vegetarian soup. Yes, it's not even mutton stew. But here we see that Esau, he agrees to exchange his, I would again like to stress, his treasured, precious possession for vegetarian soup. And then in the Bible, we read that, Bible says in Genesis 25, it says the last part of it, he ate, drank, and then got up and left, without even thinking what he did to his own life. Yes, there's no sign of regret. No, he's just happy that he got that bowl of soup. Yes, no, we all shake our heads in dismay, disbelief what he did to his own life. But then, we're like, what did he do to himself? But, are we better today? Yes, that is what we're going to see this morning. Turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 11. It says all the incidents in the Old Testament are mentioned as a warning to us, to teach us a lesson. So we're going to learn something from this incident this morning. How many of you are ready to listen to the word of God? Amen. Thank you. I have an enthusiastic crowd here. It's so good to preach. Okay. Scripture says Esau despised his birthright. No, a perfect picture of this is what I want and I want it now and I don't care about the consequence. You know, it is a strong desire that he has and he wants it immediately. You know, living for the day was his mantra, and probably that's the same thing even today. You know, now it is new, we have New Year sale and what else? Pongal sale. They say you just pay 1 rupee or you just pay 10% of the product and you can take home, you know, 42, 56 inches TV, and then just you can pay rest of it. You know, you don't care about how you can pay or when you can pay. You just take the product now. You know, today we all of us have heard about such sales and it really attracts us. But then what is it, you know, we get to know, it pinches us when we pay it every month, but when we take the product, it's just our desire being fulfilled. So, you know, we see that Esau traded his, you know, future for the present pleasure. Now, I repeat it again, Esau traded his future for his present pleasure. So when do we trade it? You know, there are times that even we trade our, you know, future for a present pleasure. So when do we do that? No, we're going to see a few things. Now, the first thing is, you know, we trade our future for the present pleasure for the fulfillment when the fulfillment of our desire becomes the most important thing for us. You know, the Bible talks about few incidents, you know, classic incidents where, you know, they traded their future just to enjoy their present pleasure. You know, when they urge to satisfy or gratify their desire blinded the consequences to that act. Yes, we have David and Bathsheba. No, David didn't give a second thought to it. The moment he saw the woman, you know, he had the desire to have her, and he didn't think about, you know, what he would answer to the husband and what would happen to his own kingdom, to his family, to his name. You know, at that time when he looked at her, he wanted to satisfy his desire. And we also have Samson, who had the desire to always have a woman next to him. And we see that, you know, it ruined and wrecked his beautiful future that God had for him. You know, he was blindfolded. He was made blind. He became a laughingstock. You know, he lost God's purpose in life just because of his nature to immediately gratify or, you know, satisfy his desire. You know, when desire becomes the first thing in our life without caring about the consequence, without thinking if it is what God has for you, we actually trade our future for the present pleasure. I remember reading an incident, probably I don't know if it was 5-6 years ago or even before that, but this thing always stuck to my mind. You know, it's about he was a managing director of IMF, you know, International Monetary Fund. His name was Dominic Strauss-Kahn. He's a French man, and he was, you know, he was going to run for the presidentship of France. He was in a very high post, and he traveled to New York for a conference, for an international conference. And when he stayed there in a hotel there, you know, he tried to molest the maid who came to serve him. And then, you know, the maid reported to police, and then there came an end to his career. You know, he was later arrested by his police, and then, you know, there was a long case running in the court, and then later we don't know whether he was convicted, but then he lost all that he had for us. He could not run for the presidentship, and then he lost his post as a managing director of IMF. You know, he lost everything, including his honor, including his name. Just that, you know, giving in to your desire for that minute ruined his future. Yes, and we don't know what he's doing right now. He's nowhere, in the news. So we see that, you know, sometimes when we run to gratify our future, our desire, without thinking of its consequence, Yes, it can ruin our future. But we have Joseph in the Bible who did not indulge to gratify, to satisfy his future, his desire, his zeal for holiness, you know, helped God accomplish his purpose, his dream in Joseph's life. Yes, amen. You know, so we need to, you know, be careful when we give in to our desires. You know, it is always Satan's trick, you know, to who always keeps telling us to satisfy our desire then and there without thinking of our of its consequence, just as Asa did. Yes, so let's be careful and give time to think about what God has for our life. The second thing is, when do we trade our future for the present pleasure? When the focus is not on eternity, but on the world. Yes, no, when Jacob wanted that bowl of soup, he did not think about what he lost. Yes, he did not think about the amount of property and the authority he would have got, you know, if he would have foregone that bowl of soup. Yes, when you think of the present pleasure of life, you know, we do not think to live with intent of eternal perspective. Yes, this is not our home. How many of you agree? Yes, which is the beautiful song, you know, Jim Rees said, you know, this world is not my home. I'm just passing through. So all of us need to live with that eternal perspective. No, this is not where I belong. No, I'm just here to fulfill God's purpose. This is just part, but my home is in heaven. You know, I'm a citizen of heaven, sings Torrin Wells. That's one of my favorite songs. Yes, so we're not of this world, but when we live with that perspective, yes, we will not involve, we will not indulge in the things of this world. Yes, you know, in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 18, what is unseen is eternal. No, let's not fix our eyes on the fleeting wealth of this world, the pleasures of the world, but let us focus on Christ and on eternity and look forward for the reward that we will have in heaven. Yes, you know, living for the eternal perspective always reminds me of my father, Pastor John Elagon. Probably few of you will know. You know, he used to come here very often a few years ago. So I've always seen him living with an eternal perspective. Nothing in this world would, you know, would satisfy him. He always lived, and you know, we lost him. He's gone to be with the Lord last 3 months back, you know, and when we hear the testimonies, we want, you know, we're always surprised to see the impact he's done on lives of people. You know, he didn't have that luxurious life that we live, but then he always lived with that eternal perspective. You know, you need to remember that all that you do on earth will, you know, will have its impact in eternity. Yes, the time that you spend in reading the Word of God, the time that you spend in the church, that energy that you, you know, that you spend for the Lord, the time that you're seated here, remember, you're sowing for eternity. Yes, what do we do on earth will pay us off in eternity. So we need to see our actions. We need to see how we spend our time. You know, I was just thinking as we entered this new year, there's one thing that God kept talking to me about, you know, time management. You know, the world talks about it. I think as a Christian, as a disciple of Christ, we need to think so much about it, because the way we spend our time on earth will pay us off in eternity. Yes? Yes? How many of you understand this? Amen. So I think we need to be more cautious. I think the secular world talks so much about time management. I think we need to be more careful about it. You know, because in Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 5, Paul says, you know, all of us will stand before the judgment seat, and all that we do in the body, we need to give account to God. It means all that we do on earth, we are accountable to God. So the time that you spend, the energy that you spend, the money that you spend, you know, we saw about that seed Sunday. I was so happy about it, because when you sow, whatever you sow on earth, it will pay you off in eternity. Yes. So, you know, you need to think about, you know, about the things that we do so that it can pay us off in it. Let our eyes be on eternity. No, let us fix our hearts on eternal things and not the things of this world. While I was just preparing this last night, you know, I had a word, probably on some of you are trying to fight for a property that you need. You know, your property, there is some problem with your property. God says, just let it go. No, we are not of this world. No, just like, no, let us not be like Asa, who did not have eternal perspective. He just didn't give a thought to what he would lose, you know, in his life. And all he had in his mind was that bowl of soup. Okay, so the next thing is, when do we trade our future for our present pleasure? When we take decision in times of physical and emotional weakness. Yes? You know, we should never take decision during our weakness, emotional or physical weakness. And when we do, many a times we make irrevocable decision which can damage our life. Yes, you know, during those times when you're weak, we see that Asa was very hungry and tired. And as I said, all that he could see was that bowl of soup and not the birthright that he lost to his brother. No, so when you're tired, when you're hurt, when you're angry, you know, just all you need to do is go to God, ask him what he has for your life and not take decision at the time of your weakness. You know, we have seen many families being shattered, many young people, you know, ruining their life because they took decision at their weakest point in their life. Probably you're hurt. You know, maybe you're working for a company and you're hurt and you just, you know, without thinking, you just quit it, the thinking of your future or the purpose that God has for your life without listening to God's voice. I think all we need during times of our weakness is God's voice. And we need to run to him at your weakness. Yes, especially when you're hurt, especially when you're angry, you know, especially when you're tired of life. You know, when people hurt you, when people throw things at you, run to God and ask him what he has for your life and don't take irrevocable decision like what Asa did. You know, we see Jesus, we have Jesus who was tempted at his weakest point. You know, after his 40 days fasting, you know, we see that, you know, Satan tempts him at his wilderness, and all of us know how Jesus overcame that temptation. You know, Satan tempts him there because he knows Jesus was at his, you know, was physically weak, and he tempts him with food. So, you know, when you're, he knows what, when what situation we are in. You know, so he tempts us according to our weakness. Maybe it's physical or mental or whatever it is. Just like Jesus, we need to overcome it with the word of God. No, we had this beautiful worship today where, no, the focus was on Jesus, no, the overcomer. So all of us are overcomers. Amen. And we will not fall to Satan's prey, especially at our weakness, and we will overcome him and his temptation just as Jesus did. You know, Charles F. Stanley talks about the HALT principle, you know, H-A-L-T. He says, whenever you are hungry, H, no, angry, A, L, lonely or tired, be careful, because especially at that time you're vulnerable to sin. You know, don't take a decision. He says, stop and seek God. You know, remember during your halt, remember this halt principle. Yes, stop and seek God. Know what God has for your life. You know, the more you give in to your feelings, your weakness, you know, you will look to gratify your own needs away from God. Yes, you know, and you will reap the terrible consequence like just what Asa did. Yes, you know, we see that, you know, choices that we make for our life will have drastic consequence on us and on our generation. Yes, you know, all that you do in life, all that you decide in life, you know, all that you choose in life will have, I want to repeat that again, will have a, you know, to have a drastic consequence on you and on your generation. Yes, the choices that you make as a youth. You know, many a time I can say that me and my husband, we are blessed in every way because, you know, the first reason is God, and then next it is our parents. All that our parents did for God's kingdom. Now I'm sure this church, this congregation, the generation of Pastor Job Gnanapragasam is blessed because of what uncle and auntie did. And you know, what Pastor David Pragasam and his wife did, and his generation has been blessed. So whatever decision that you take, whatever choices you make, remember that will not just affect you, it will affect your generation. Because we see Asa's generation, you know, did not get the blessings of God. Now in Malachi 1:3 and Obadiah 1:18, God talks about Asa's generation. It says, the hill country turned into wasteland. It talks about Asa's, you know, inheritance. God says his hill country turned into a wasteland and left his inheritance to the desert jackals. And in Obadiah 1:18 says, there will be no survivors from Asa, says the Lord. Now that one decision what Asa took when he was tired at his weakest point, you see that it affected the generations. Yes? So the choice is yours. Don't trade your future for your present pleasure. Yes? What is our bowl of soup this morning? Yes? You know, probably different people will have different things for their life. Your bowl of soup will be different from mine. Now, I just want to pick few things. It can be different, but, you know, the few things I just wanted to mention. And I have a bowl here and few papers. And, you know, I'll just pick one and we're going to see the first thing is food. Your bowl of soup is your bowl of soup. Yes. You know, I come from Madurai, you know, where food is the most important thing. Yes, whenever I look at food, you know, this thing always comes to my mind. A minute on your lips, forever on your hips. Yes. You know, there are few people for whom, you know, as I said, food is their bowl of soup. You don't care about the future. I will eat as long as I live. I don't care how many years I live, but as long as I live, eat to my full and, you know, don't care about the future. Yes. No, we need to be careful about how we take care of this temple of the Holy Spirit. Yes, you know, as we start the year, I think we need to take decisions. We need to change the lifestyle. You know, if you've been into unhealthy eating habits, practices, I think it's, you know, again, more than the world, you know, we need to be careful of how we take care of this temple of God. Yes, you know, because through this, we need to give glory to God. You know, when God looks at us, when people look at us, you know, they need to give glory to God. So, you know, let not food be your real bowl of soup, just the way it was for Asa. The next thing is relationship. Any relationships that takes you away from God is your bowl of soup. You know, it's not just for young people here. Even for people who are married, you know, I don't know how many young mothers are here. Many times, you know, I've seen, it's a group and church, I've seen, you know, as a young person, they'll come to church, they're very active in the church. And even after marriage, you know, slowly they'll start deteriorating. And then once they have their child, you know, probably for some time they'll stop coming to church, and then you come to the church after half an hour after the church starts, and then suddenly you realize it's time for breakfast, then you take the child out for breakfast, and by the time you come back the service is over. Yes, anything that takes you away from God, I'm sorry to say this, will not be a blessing in your life. Any relationship. Yes, so we need to be careful and see our life in the light of God's word and see if there's any relationship that is taking us away from God. Be it your own children or your friends, your family, your colleagues, no matter what your age is, yes, any relationship that takes you away from the blessing of God is your bowl of soup. And let us analyze our life and see what it is. The next thing is, the first thing you cannot relate much, maybe it's alcohol, drugs, smoking. And the next thing what we can really relate is our electronic gadget. Yes, phone, TV, gaming device, pornography, any addiction. What is our addiction this morning? Yes, I think everybody is talking about that small piece of phone that we have in our hands all the time. Yes, and I think, it is slow. I don't know if I can say slowly, but it is taking our time from the Lord. Yes, if you have to calculate if the ratio between the time we spend with the phone and with the Lord, it shouldn't even be equal. But then, most of the time it's more than we spend time with the Lord. Yes, let us see our life, search our hearts and see if any addiction is taking us away from the Lord. That it is a bowl of soup for us this morning. Let us learn to throw away anything that comes in the way of the Lord for us. Yes, anything that takes the place of the Lord. In Ezekiel, he talks about the idol in our hearts. Let's check our life and see if we have any idol in our hearts. Isaiah talks about, says they worshiped the Lord, they also worshiped their own gods. Here God is saying this when he talks about Israelites. Many a times we worship God, we come to church, but do we have the other things that we worship? Do other things take the place of God in our lives? Okay, we have to see this. The last thing is, anger, hatred, bitterness, or unforgiveness that we have in our life. These things can be a bowl of soup, where we miss God's blessing in our life when we do not forgive people, when we harbor anger in our lives. Yes, all of us know, God says, unless you forgive your neighbor, you will not be forgiven. So if we are not forgiven, we cannot enter the kingdom of God. Yes, so we need to see our life and we have to see if we have any unforgiveness in our hearts. In Ephesians, it says, forgive others the way Christ forgave us. So let's see our hearts, let's search our hearts and see if we have anything against anybody else. If you have anger, bitterness against people, let's learn to forgive people just the way Christ forgave us. Before I conclude, I just want to quote this words where Paul said, he talks about the difference between I can do anything versus is it beneficial for me? For the world or for people who are new to Christ, it is between sin and it's not a sin. I'm sure all of us are matured Christians. And for the matured Christian, it's not about sin and it's not sin. It's between I can do anything versus is it beneficial? I have the right to do versus Is it constructive? You know, turn with me to 1 Corinthians 10:23. You know, it says, I can do anything, but is it beneficial for me? What I do, will it have its impact in eternity? No, what I do, will it impact me and my generation? The next thing is, you know, I have right to do anything, Paul says, but we need to see if it is constructive. If what I do will benefit the kingdom of God. Yes, you know, we need to analyze our lives with the light of God's word. The choice is ours. No, I want to conclude saying Asa did not imagine the unimaginable wealth, position, power, and authority, and the greater spiritual inheritance that he lost because he despised his birthright. He saw the present bowl of soup, the present pleasure and the fun that he had. You know, don't lose what God has for your life. You know, Isaiah 64:4 and 1 Corinthians 2:9 says, no one has conceived, no ears have heard what God has in store for us. God has great plans for you, church. He has things that you have not even conceived in your heart. This morning when I woke up, I had this verse from Ephesians 3:20 where it says, you know, he can do more than what you can ask, more than what you can imagine in your life. He has beautiful plans, plans to prosper and not to destroy you. Yes, he has great plans that you haven't even conceived. You haven't even thought about your life. But only if you can surrender your life to the purpose and will of God in your life and forgo the present pleasure and fun that can distract you from God's purpose in your life. Let's learn to surrender our life to God this morning. You know, God is a, you know, he's a good God, and he doesn't, you know, force anything on us. You know, God has given us self-will. Yes, the choice is ours. Let us not lose God's beautiful plans for our life, just the way Asa lost the birthright in his life. It says he despised his birthright. Do we despise God's plan in our life by yielding to our present pleasure, yielding to gratify our desires this morning? Do we think and see what all that we do in life will have eternal blessing, eternal perspective? Do we have that eternal perspective in our life? Or do we think about the fleeting wealth of this world? Do we take decision at our weakest point of time? Or do we run to God and ask him what he has for our life? And how we need to deal with people around us when we are hurt or angry or lonely or tired? No? The choice is ours this morning. And as we enter this year, let's ask God, let us be led by God. Let us be sensitive to the voice of the Holy Spirit when the choice is yours. Let God take his course in our life, and let us inherit the beautiful blessing that God has for our life. You know, can we turn with me to 1 Corinthians 2:9? Let's all read this verse together. But as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor has entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love him. Amen. Amen. God has prepared beautiful inheritance for you. Now, what you do will have an impact on you and your generation. So do things that God has for you. Stay in the perfect will of God. Fulfill God's purpose in your life and enjoy his blessings for generations and generations. Amen. Amen. Now, I would request my husband to just, you know, conclude.
Hallelujah. Amen. It's a needed message for a needed hour. I believe this year God said that I will do wonders. Amen. Exceedingly, abundantly, more than we ask or imagine. But if God wants to do something new in our life, we need to do something. Amen. We need to set right something. Amen. We need to leave our bowl of soup. Amen. How many of you really liked that sermon today? I am enjoyed. I'm first time I'm hearing this sermon from my wife. And I know that while I was listening to it, as she said, amen, let us ponder ourselves. Let us examine ourselves and inquire ourselves, what is our bowl of soup? What is stopping you? Amen. As she said, it might be your food. Amen. It might be your phone. Or it might be your child. Or it might be your job. Amen. Just examine yourself and God will help us. Amen. Definitely help us. So while I was sitting there, I thought of, God reminded about Daniel. Daniel fasting. Daniel fasted for 3 weeks because he got a vision from God. Bible says, Daniel chapter 10, verse 1, on the third year, he saw a vision. He understood the vision concerned even certain things going to happen in future. When he saw that vision about the future, what is going to happen, Bible says that Daniel, he had been mourning for 3 whole weeks. All the time, he had not eaten rich food, no meat, no wine crossed my lips. I used no fragrant lotions until those 3 weeks has passed. So, amen. So 21 days fast. What are you going to fast? What is your bowl of soup? You can fast. For example, let me tell you, if you are a foodie, now I see in every Coimbatore is known for food, no? That only business that succeeded during lock time is hotel. Many people, amen. If it's, food is your, some people say that, Pastor, I cannot eat without non-vegetarian. If you're like that, if you're like, as my wife said, Madurai, known for food. I mean, when I got married, my wife got, I mean, she's shocked to see how much I eat. Once we went there for a honeymoon, we went there, one of my friend just gave us a beautiful place in Malaysia, Indonesia, Malaysia. Malaysia, we were, he hosted us and we went, he made us to board in a very nice hotel. The morning, that breakfast, I think more than 300 or 400 dishes, right? I said, my friend paid so much, so I need to taste everything. my wife, she was so shocked to see me. How do you do that? So while I was sitting, so I'm going to do 21 days fast. No non-vegetarian. Some might be like addicted to sweets. So you can, whatever, some people take fasting, whatever they can do it. For example, like some people, non-vegetarian is not a big deal. So for them, what is your big deal? Do it. Some people, my wife, big deal is sweets. So already she's in fast, right? She's in fast for 40 days. She didn't touch sweets so far. So what I'm trying to say this morning is 21 days. Why we do this? Because we'll have a control over it. I mean, we won't fulfill the desires of our flesh. Amen. Amen. Some people, I'm just giving you illustrations, some examples. You can do 21 days, no Facebook. My sister, my wife's sister, often she does WhatsApp fasting. She will send a message telling us, another 2 weeks, I won't be available in WhatsApp. Please contact me through message. Or you can do Facebook, 21 days fasting. Whatever you, like, he said that whatever like he desired, he just let it go for 21 days. So 21 days, no Insta. Amen. You can just imagine, just think about your life. What is stopping you? What is hindering you? What is disturbing you? You know that this thing, this stuff is stopping me. This stuff is really, it's not helping me to fulfill God's plan in my life. God's calling is being interrupted by because of this thing. If you have that something in your life, I mean, take a decision. Just 21 days, do it. God will give control over everything. Amen. 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 Let me say one word and complete it. While I was sitting, I was reminded of this. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 25. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 25. It talks about Moses. Moses. He chose to be mistreated along with the people of God rather than to enjoy the fleeting pleasure of sin. That's a beautiful word. He was a prince. He can live a luxurious life. But he chose, do you know that? He chose to be mistreated along with the people of God rather than to enjoy the fleeting pleasure of this world. You know, Egypt is like US that time. That was a top country. I mean, Egypt denotes world. He was a prince, but he rather chose to mistreat it along with the child of God. Amen. So let us all kill our desire this 21 days. Amen. Amen. From today onwards, we are going to kill our desires that stopping the calling of God in our lives. Amen. So don't kill your wife. Pastor said 21 days, because I love you so much, I'm going to leave you for 21 days. No, no, no. Amen. Let's all, amen, do something what God expects us, and God will take care of our future. Amen. Shall we all stand up to our feet? Amen. May God help us. Amen. What is your bowl of soup? So we're going to get rid of that for another 21 days. Amen. May God help you and me. Amen. So that we can fulfill the God's plan in our lives. Amen. Hallelujah. Always I used to say, no demon or no man or no power on earth can destroy the plan of God in your life. But that is the danger word. But you can destroy it. Like Asa, you can destroy it. It's in your hands. As I said, devil cannot destroy your future. But he will distract you so that you will be disqualified. Amen. Let us leave every distraction this year. I believe that God has something great in store for you. No eyes are seen, no ears are heard. What God has in store for those who love Him. Shall we all lift up our eyes? Let us lift up our hands. Look into the Lord. Lord, help me, God. Help me, Jesus. You spoke to us so clearly what we need to do this year. Thank you so much for your word. We know our weakness, God. We know why we are here. We know the reason why we are not able to succeed in life. We know the reasons, Father God. Today morning you have pointed out that we lay our lives. Have your way. Shall we all lift up? Have your way in us, God. Have your way in us. Have your way in us. You increase, I decrease. Lord, you increase, I decrease, God. Have your way in me. Have your way in my life. have your way in my life. Like Daniel, maybe you can go home and pray and decide and do 21 days fast. Whatever it might be, as I said, it might be a phone, it might be a food, it might be a non-vegetarian, it might be anything that is stopping God's presence in your life. Have your way, God. Thank you, Jesus. Let your will be done. Let your will be done. Let your will be done. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done. Let your will be done. Let your kingdom come. Let your kingdom come. How many of you can say the Lord, let your kingdom come, let your will be done. Give us our daily bread. Forgive our sins as we forgive our brothers, God. Shall we lift our hands? Let the kingdom of God come over your life. Let the kingdom of God take over your life. Let the kingdom of God lead you from this time onwards. Holy Spirit, how many of you can say that I'm ready, Pastor? I'm ready to obey whatever God has said today. I'm ready to leave my bowl of soap. I'm ready to leave. I'm ready to, Father God, obey to your voice. If you can say that, you can raise your hands and I want to pray for you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. This year is a wonder for them. Wonder for them. Thank you, Jesus. Whatever you're going to do this year in their life, people are going to be astonished. Lord, thank you, Lord, for you settling many things in their life this year. You're settling many things in their life. Thank you, Father God. They're going to be 10 times better than others this year. Better than their colleagues, better than the neighbors, Father God. Like Daniel, they're going to be 10 times better. Thank you, Jesus. I bless them this year, Father God. Let their plan and purpose prevail in their life. Lord, give them brand new start, Father God. In the Old Testament, if you have done anything wrong, that's all gone. Everything is finished. But because of Jesus, I tell you, you have another chance. You have a second chance. Bible says that I will rebuild the fallen temple of David. I pray that whatever they have lost it because of bowl of soup, whatever they have failed, and this time they're going to conquer it, Father God. They're going to be more than conquerors. Hallelujah. I pray that this year they're going to achieve. This year they're going to achieve great things for God. This year they're going to attempt great things for God. And they're going to achieve great things for God. I pray that this year is a year of achievement for them. They're going to be a climbers like Joseph. We see that Joseph was a climber. Whatever the wall has been laid, whatever the wall has been set before him, he climbed over every wall. In the name of Jesus, let them be a conquerors like Joseph, Father God. I pray that this year they're going to achieve something new and great for the glory of God. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen, 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 amen.